Okay. Good morning, everybody. Mark Whistler with FX Volatility here. Thank you so much, FX Street. Thank you, Maud. Thank you, ES. And thank you so much, Dinda. And it's a pleasure to see everybody here this morning. Looks like we have a healthy group. And I'm extremely thrilled to bring you an hour of Volatility Illuminated. And today we will be discussing all of the factors that go into excessive volatility within FX markets. And we will also attempt to cover some of the pertinent technical issues that will face traders within the upcoming months as well. So with that in mind, again, my name is Mark Whistler with FX Volatility, and I would like to mention really quick that at no point in time is any of our discussion today a direct recommendation to buy or sell. And if possible, I will actually also be trading live and in real time. If I do so, the account that I'll be trading is hypothetical. That's to reiterate that today's webinar is for educational purposes only, and that if participants do choose to trade along with me, that I request that you please only use a hypothetical educational account as well. So with that in mind, we'll go ahead and get started. Thank you so much, Gopher Up. I hope you, okay, great, great. I hope you received my email this morning as well. Great. And Boyke, hi, Boyke. I'm so happy to see everybody here again. I really actually enjoy the Monday morning webinars. It seems like it's a very, it's a smaller group of very serious traders. And in the past few weeks on our Monday webinars, we've actually been taking a little time to go over more detailed information and work with everybody, I think, a little bit more one-on-one to be able to really decipher some of the volatility currently facing FX markets. And just out of curiosity, how many people here have felt like recently they've had a little bit of a rough ride in Forex, especially over the last 6 months, and maybe even more so in the last November, December, and January? How's the volatility picture for everybody? Do we have any commentary, any thoughts there that anybody would like to share with the room? Anything that that anybody's particularly noticed as far as volatility within markets? Is anybody capitalizing on volatility and making a fortune from it? Okay, looks like we're not too active this morning as far as comments from the room, but that's okay. And I just want to check really quick: is my audio level okay? By the way, the meter isn't really spiking like it should, but as long as it's okay, I won't worry about it. Okay, great. Thanks, Mark. Okay, I have a little video that I want to share with you, and it's about 3 minutes long. This video actually is, as you know, occasionally I start my webinars with rock videos, but today actually it's something a little bit different. And this is actually an experience that I had about a summer ago, and I think that it really kind of applies to FX markets in today's market specifically. And I'm hoping that you'll kind of understand and see the semblance of why I'm showing it. So give me just a moment. We'll get it started here. And also, by the way, just as a quick update, the upcoming rule change within Forex, which will is not allowing stops or normal stops and limit orders within trading platforms, will not take effect until July 31st. Just in case anybody here was wondering, hey, John Noel. So just FYI, please be aware that that rule change is on the way, though, and it is going to change the dynamics of FX markets. Last Monday or Thursday, we actually discussed some of the potential impacts that could have. At the end of the day, the removal of stops and limits orders from FX markets, or at least U.S. trading platforms, could actually help create a situation where we see longer periods of trending, while at the same time could actually create more volatility at moments of extreme reversals. And this is, I think, something that everybody here certainly needs to be well aware of. So please note that in your mind, and please simply just be readily available, or excuse me, readily aware that the situation is obviously transpiring. So, with that in mind, how many people here can, or who can tell me some of the components of volatility that perhaps we've covered in some past webinars? Just out of curiosity, so I can kind of gauge the overall understanding of volatility within all of the room's participants. Do we have any thoughts at all? Not so much. Okay. Well, that's certainly all right, too. Okay. First and foremost, within our discussion of volatility, we have to understand that obviously there are multiple components comprising today's FX markets that are changing quickly in our ever-increasing light-speed world of technology. And what used to work 3 or 4 or 5 years ago is no longer proving to have the same efficacy as it does today within today's market. And it's extremely important for traders to realize that there is a larger breakdown in the paradigm of being able to trust technicals. At the end of the day, because we now have a mass army of technical traders all taking positions at the same time with the same information based on preloaded, preset variables within their FX platforms, we have a situation where we have too many people actually acting on the same information at the same time. In some sense, we would normally think that the more people acted on the same information at the same time would actually create a type of self-fulfilling prophecy. That would be our initial logical thinking behind such. However, the unfortunate problem and the unfortunate reality of today is that when you have too many people acting on the same information at the exact same time, assuming maybe they're taking a short position, perhaps on a shooting star candlestick pattern on a 30-minute chart, while stochastics are rolling from above 80, below 80, if you have an entire army of retail traders who are taking a position all at the same time, what would happen if there was a little bit of excess volatility on the upside all at the same time as well? Any thoughts there? Well, at the end of the day, the bottom line result is we see an excessive period of volatility on the opposite side of the candle or the chart which produced the original signal. And this is a paradigm that unfortunately is not going to change anytime soon, because obviously as more people become accustomed to and grow aware of the FX world, then obviously we're just going to see more and more traders surface. And unfortunately, the larger problem is that not many retail traders, especially the newer traders, truly take time to educate themselves within paradigm of volatility, and B, the true understanding and perception of why that volatility is surfacing in the first place. And just for a little bit of proof of the pudding here, and as we see, when we look at the euro Australian dollar here on a 30-minute basis, we see as the euro begins to climb steeply. On the 30-minute chart, obviously, we start to see significant potential reversal indicators, as noted in the obviously the doji forming at the very top of our chart here, and we can see that there was actually one previously 3 candles ago. For the average typical trader who's just obviously moving in and out of positions based on preloaded lock, stock, and barrel traditional indicators within their platforms, obviously taking a short position or a reversal position might seem like a viable opportunity at this moment. However, the reality of this situation is that if we actually look into what happened shortly afterwards, there's a steep continued climb. And so we have to ask ourselves, why is it exactly that when we see, or when we're beginning to see technical indicator surface that potentially once had some semblance of accuracy, we're seeing almost complete failure in today's market. And when we truly ask ourselves why that is, it is obviously because, one, the technical indicator is not an accurate an accurate insight or snapshot into institutional order flow, A, and B, obviously because we have a mass army of retail traders who are all taking positions at the exact same time. On the previous doji candle that I showed you, clearly if you have an entire mass army of traders who are taking positions based off that candlestick alone, and obviously without any other truly significant information coming into their decision or their overall trading mindset, then obviously what's going to happen when we start to break out above that candle just slightly? Of course, those traders are going to be forced to cover those positions as quickly as possible, and because they're forced to actually cover those positions quickly, the instance would actually begin to show excessive volatility on the upside, which traditionally may have not been apparent within markets only a few years previously. And another point that I'd like to show is that if we actually go back and look at the exact same scenario, we can see that our stochastics right on time, our stochastics is above 80, and we start to see an almost precise, and I'll blow up the chart here just a little bit so everybody can see it exactly. We start to see an almost precise crossover of our traditional, we'll get back to our candle there. If I can find the little guy here, he's disappeared. There we go. Okay, when we actually drill down into the chart here and look at it as perhaps we might have been seeing it real time, we'll notice that obviously stochastics was trading above 80. Clearly in this scenario, the average retail trader or most traders are usually actually looking for a reversal. And how many people here, or can anybody here, if anybody here could answer this question, I would be very grateful. Can anybody here actually tell me what it means when stochastics is actually trading above 80 or below 20? Or even better yet, can anybody here actually tell me, I think another common indicator that many traders actually use, is our CCI. Can anybody here actually tell me what it means precisely when CCI is trading above 100 or below negative 100? And any thoughts there? Overbought. Okay. And Dennis, what is overbought? We need to take a moment to challenge these concepts. Okay. What is, I sure will, John, we'll cover all of that. And, Bernsey, what exactly is, yep, and John, that's correct. Do you know, what the deviation is? Excuse me if I pick on you for just a little bit here. John is a great trader, everybody, by the way, from what I've noticed. I think you're, in a few moments here, I think you're going to be awfully surprised at the information that we begin to see when we truly understand what's kind of happening under the surface. Because these indicators come preloaded in every single trading platform, and because the descriptions of such on how to use them are incredibly, hey, thanks, John. That was really nice of you to say. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to switch screens here really quick. Because the explanations of the indicators are incredibly, I'm not sure what the proper word would be here or the proper phrase, they're incredibly vague within themselves. How is it that the retail trader would ever actually truly have any understanding whatsoever of what's really happening within FX markets? And what I mean by this is when you examine obviously what's happening within CCI and and even stochastics. And of course, everybody knows above 80 is overbought, but below is oversold. And for CCI, we're taught that above 100 is overbought and below negative 100 is oversold. But really, what does that mean? And that's we have to challenge this. We have to truly challenge exactly what's happening within the information underneath, obviously, the indicators that we are taking action on. The bottom line is supply and demand. Dennis, everything is supply and demand, but technically, no. What I'm going to show you in just a moment here is, now I was hoping MetaTrader might have an excellent explanation of their indicators here, which hopefully they might. We'll take a peek here. There we go. Okay. If we take a look at MetaTrader's Meta Editors, and can everybody actually see my screen here? Okay, great. You can see the explanation of commodity channel index. Okay, great. When we actually take a look at the larger definition of CCI, clearly it basically tells us that we have two strategies here. One is finding the divergences, and I'm just going to read these. If you don't mind, the divergence appears when price reaches a new maximum and commodity channel index cannot grow above the previous maximums. This classical divergence is normally followed by the price action. And number two is as an indicator of overbuying and overselling. Commodity channel index usually varies in the range of positive to negative 100. Values above positive 100 inform about overbuying state and about a probability of correcting decay. And the values below 100 inform of the overselling state and about a probability of correcting increase. So let's ask ourselves, what the heck do they mean by that? What do they mean by the probability of correcting increase? And what do they mean about exactly an inform about overbuying state? And what exactly is the overbuying state? And not only that, what exactly is the these key levels that they're showing, what do they mean? And when we even go into the actual calculation, we see that basically we have a typical price equals the high plus low plus close divided by 3, right? That's right. Okay, then we have the moving average, and obviously we're going to sum the typical price for however many periods, which is the simple moving average, and then, of course, we're going to divide that by the total periods. And then, as you can see, obviously, we're for our deviation. What they are calling the deviation is we are going to take our typical price. We're going to subtract it from the simple moving average, and then obviously that simple moving average was previously multiplied by the typical price and however many periods, or excuse me, was this the sum of those periods. And then from there, we're even going to move through two more brief calculations here. But at the end of the day, the bottom line is that we're going to take all of the information that we've collected, and we're going to multiply it by 0.015. Does anybody have any idea what this means to us? Even on a probability on a probability volatility basis. And I know we're moving a little bit slow right now, but I request that everybody please stay with me. And part of the reason why I'm moving a little slower than usual is because I think once you just have a slight insight to the complete breakdown in information and understanding that is offered to most traders on what is really happening underneath the technical indicators that you depend on, that you trust, that you act on, that you actually trade upon with real money. I think when you understand the true breakdown of that paradigm, that virtually almost all traders are literally walking through markets blind every single day, retail traders, I think that it will immediately open your eyes to the true volatility paradigm within FX markets, at least for short intraday pops of volatility inherent with obviously the retail trading community. And also is, in my opinion, a significant reason why, obviously, the stop rule changes have taken place. Because at the same time, when you have a mass army of retail traders all taking positions at the exact same place at the exact same time, when those positions move against that same army, of course those stops are electronically tripped globally. And if you imagine lights rolling out in a blackout as the lights go out across the city, the same thing is happening with those stop orders globally, and they're just driving volatility opposite of the true direction of trending, obviously for a short-term basis, until those lights come back on. And I think that the larger mindset is that by removing stop orders, then obviously you won't have so many traders obviously putting in those stops at the exact same places, or at least they won't be able to affect those stops at the exact same places because they will actually be pulling the trigger themselves instead of letting the computer do it for them. So with that in mind, I have a quick little video here that will lead us into, obviously, the next part of our conversation where we truly start to see why and how volatility is currently present. And I think that you're about to have an amazing aha moment on exactly why we have to dig deeper into the volatility paradigm overall. So I hope you enjoyed this this little video, and this is a video about volatility. It's about rapid movement upward and rapid movement downward.
Nice and sunny up there. So how are you feeling this time? All right, yeah, you've had plenty of time to build up the anticipation, right? All right, anybody back home you need to say hi to before we take off? Right, right. Well, I got stuff to do later, so none of that. All right, let's go have some fun, man. Enjoy yourself.
Here's the link. That's a bummer for sure. Oh, very pixelated. Okay, gotcha. Anyway, as I was preparing for this webinar, I tried to think about what most traders must feel like almost every single day, most retail traders. And the closest thing that I could possibly come up with was an experience that I had jumping out of an airplane. And literally, stepping out of the airplane was a feeling of almost sheer panic. And then obviously free-falling for over 30 to 45 seconds was amazing. But I think sometimes most traders probably have to feel that sense of sheer panic when their positions move against them and they have absolutely no idea why. Also with the video, even though I guess apparently you couldn't quite see it, I actually felt reasonably relieved as I jumped out of the airplane. No, Boyki Dharma wasn't with me. I actually felt or at least a little bit comfortable because obviously there was a parachute, a skydiving instructor with me. But I wonder if I hadn't, if he hadn't been there, obviously, you know, I mean, what would have happened? Would I have locked up when I needed to pull the chute? Would I have jumped at all? Would I have obviously landed in the right place, or would have I landed in the ocean? I mean, obviously, you know, I was lucky to have this guy who, and I think he had jumped over 3,000 times. I was lucky to have that guy with me, and at first, obviously, I thought to myself, gee, I don't want somebody to jump out of the plane with me. But then actually, when the airplane started rising, I thought, you know, I'm really glad this guy is here, obviously, because you know, once you're actually there, a lot of things change. Well, the bottom line is that I think that a lot of traders currently, basically on a day-to-day basis, are stepping out of the airplane of trading with their own money, about a year ago, Boyke, with their own money, and yet they have no chute. In fact, they don't even understand how and why a chute is not only important but absolutely vital to their survival on a day-to-day basis. So let's go back into CCI that I just explained and talk about exactly what's happening. The retail community is basically told that a CCI trading over positive 100 means overbought, and obviously trading below negative 100 means oversold. Well, let's go into these actual definitions of the word overbought, oversold. How many people here think overbought actually means a reversal could be pending very soon? Because that's kind of what the word sounds like to me. Because that's really that's overbought means in my mind an excessive enough amount of buying that obviously the potential or the probability of a reversal would obviously increase significantly very soon, right? And in fact, amazingly, if we actually go into the definition that was just applied to you in MetaTrader, it even stated that obviously that trading above 100 and negative 100 and CCI actually increased the probability of a reversal. So may I ask how many people in the room actually use CCI as a trending, with the trend indicator, or how many people actually use it as an indicator of potential reversal pending? Any thoughts there? And again, I know that I'm moving a little bit slow here, but it's the theoretical underpinning of exactly why volatility occurs. The information you receive, the information that you are acting on, the information that you are trading upon on a day-to-day basis, it is built for failure from the get-go. You are set up to fail. And I think, and most traders don't even realize that this instance is occurring. And I'm about to prove it to you. And so we have, what would be the difference with RSI? Well, mostly RSI. And okay, so Linda, you use mostly RSI for a reversal indicator. Okay. And just out of curiosity, how many traders here actually believe that that the greatest potential profits or moves, what can I do about to not fail? Not, you betcha. Hardly sacks. On the way. Well, to begin with, what we have to understand is that even the explanation of the technical indicators that you're receiving on a day-to-day basis are also providing you with false information, are providing you with a false sense of security, and are also geared towards setting the retail trader up with the mentality that the bulk of the large money to be made within trading is based on being able to time larger reversals, to be able to be a contrarian, to be able to pick off tops and pick off bottoms. In fact, when we actually look at the bulk of the true indicators out there that come lock stock in most trading platforms for the retail trader, we see that really the explanations when we look at stochastics, when we look at CCI, when we look at MACD, when we look at even Fibonacci retracements, every single one of those, obviously not everyone, but the majority of them really attempt to condition the retail trader mind to the possibility that he or she can make substantial money off of obviously reversal pending, if and only if he or she is perceptive enough to be able to time those reversals correctly. Well, let me show you something different here that I think is going to open your eyes dramatically to volatility within today's market, and also why the indicators that you have lock stock in your trading platform and the explanation of such is really setting you up for failure. And bear with me for one moment, please. And please again take note that when we look at the actual explanation in MetaTrader on what CCI is, we see that again it says finding divergences, A, and B, it says as an indicator of overbuying and overselling. Again, let's remember these terms, overbuying and overselling. Then if we actually take a look at the truth of the situation, here's what we have to understand. First, we'll back up to the actual origination of CCI as an indicator itself. Okay, great. So let's consider, obviously, what's happening here. First of all, we know that CCI was founded in 1980 by a man named Don Lambert, I believe. And Don Lambert actually, it's my understanding that he basically created CCI to attempt to identify the larger cyclical nature of movements of commodities. Well, let's understand exactly what is the cyclical nature. The cyclical nature, if we truly kind of take the time to even unearth just a little bit of the paradigm of the term cyclical nature, is obviously it means that that something must not only move up but back down, and so it means that we basically obviously like there are four seasons, obviously like we have 24 hours in a day, while time basically ascends on a clock. If you just assumed, on a 12-hour clock, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, and then we kind of come back to a lower number. Well, obviously within this cyclical nature of an indicator, there would be the absolute requirement for divergence or expansion or the necessity of overbuying as the indicator author here, as the explanation author explains in MetaTrader. It would be the absolute necessity for that overbuying and overselling to exist, and in the first place, to have the second part of the cycle, which obviously is the fallback back in. Okay, so if we actually take a look at CCI here in the true understanding of what's happening, what we can do when we really basically dig into the information, we start to understand that it's not just a number of negative 100 to positive 100. What we're really talking about is a measurement of probability away from the mean. And another item is that obviously actually standard deviation, or excuse me, CCI is measured in what's called MAD, mean absolute deviation. It is not the same as standard deviation. However, based on the principles of descriptive statistics, we can begin to infer that there are some similarity between the MAD deviation and the standard deviation. The bottom line is that while even the authors of MetaTrader basically just told you that obviously trading above positive 100 means overbought and trading below negative 100 means oversold, the reality of the situation, the truth of the situation, is that actually trading above positive 100 really means that we're trading above the 1.25 or 1.5 standard deviation in the larger distribution. In effect, the negative 100 to positive 100 area within the CCI is truly only is only meant to measure 75%, to have a 95% confidence that 75% of the values will lie within that area, will lie within negative 100 to positive 100. If I were to turn the image that you're seeing here sideways, this would actually be CCI. And CCI basically, obviously, in terms of a normal Gaussian distribution, we know that there's a 68% probability that all of the data should lie within one standard deviation of the mean. We know that there's a 95.5% probability that all of the data should lie within two standard deviations of the mean. And we know that there is a 99.7 probability that all of the data should lie within three standard deviations of the mean. What we also know is that basically, at the end of the day, Once we start trading out above the first standard deviation in any distribution, the likelihood of moving to the second or third distribution increases significantly. What's more, on a short-term basis, the likelihood of moving outside of the first standard deviation is significantly higher than moving outside of the first standard deviation on a longer-term basis, and it's simply because we're measuring less data. So the bottom line is that above positive 100 and below negative 100 is really not overbought or oversold whatsoever. And actually, if we take a look at a chart here, you can see what I've done is I've actually mapped out a distribution here. This is the distribution of the market. And then I've also overlaid a 1.25 Bollinger Band here, which measures is meant to measure about 75% have a 75% probability that all of the data will lie inside of these two lines. Well, what it means basically is that really when we start to move outside of those lines, we're talking about a larger movement outside of one standard deviation from the mean. And when we start to break the first standard deviation, the probability of breaking further out to the second or third standard deviation increases rapidly. So in effect, when we start to trade above positive 100 and below negative 100, it does not mean we're overbought or oversold at all. It simply means that there's enough buying momentum that we've moved beyond the 1.25. It simply means we've moved beyond the first standard deviation. And it's absolutely absurd to think for 1 second that trading beyond the first standard deviation would require any instance whatsoever or demand the instance of mean reversion. And in fact, you'll also notice on my chart here what I've done is I've shown exactly where you can see that when CCI drops back below negative 100, you can also see in the exact same place where the Euro-US dollar here on the 4-hour chart falls back underneath the first standard deviation. But if you actually take a look, and I don't think you guys can see my hot pointer here, unfortunately, which I wish you could. But if you take a look at the chart of the at the Euro-US dollar that I'm presenting, and you see the first up and down arrow from CCI that I've drawn to the left, well, if you actually take a look and draw just walk forward to the right 6 bars, you'll notice that we trade outside of that positive 100 area within CCI. Well, for the following 4 candles, we continue to trade outside of that area above positive 100 on CCI. If we go all the way back to the left side of our chart, when you see the Euro-US dollar first break underneath that first standard deviation, you see that CCI is trading below negative 100. And you can see that the Euro-US dollar for 6 bars drops rapidly and fiercely. The reason for the extended movement, for the torrid downward movement, there are two of them on this chart, actually, and even when you see the excessive pops on the top side above the first standard deviation. The reason for the torrid downward movements outside of the first standard deviation is because you are trading outside of the first standard deviation. And trading outside of the first standard deviation on a distribution, if we just consider just traditional volatility and probability, trading outside of the first standard deviation really demands that we actually will begin to excessively move towards the second and the third standard deviation. If we really take a look at what's happening here, one, the information that you receive, even in MetaTrader here, even in the information, even in their explanation of what CCI is misleading. It's wrong, and it is prompting traders to look for a reversal, to look for a reversal because of the words overbought and oversold at the precise minute when they should be looking for trending instead. Even MetaTrader has given you the exact wrong information, setting you up precisely for failure at exactly all of the right moments. It is true that if you are trading with the trend, If you, and I'll just pull over to my chart here, it is true that if you are trading with the trend, and all of a sudden CCI, you know, if you're trading up, let me pull this up here really quick. If we look, I'm not sure if you can actually see it. I'm not sure. Maybe I can draw some lines here. And bear with me for one moment. It is true that if you are trading with the trend and CCI crosses from above, say if the trend is down, and CCI crosses from above positive 100 below negative 100, yes, that would be a good time to take a position with, obviously, the previous trend, looking for that reversal. But why is that? It's not because the currency pair was overbought or oversold. It's not because we were truly overbought or oversold. What the instance really means is that we were trading above or below the first standard deviation, and the pair has simply now moved back below the first standard deviation. And so what Lambert was really attempting to identify in creating CCI in the first place was how to capitalize on those sweet spots of a cyclical relationship. But the bottom line is that as soon as you, if you imagine a circle, if you imagine, you know, kind of an orbit, basically when CCI trades outside of that first standard deviation, it's really kind of, it's just starting to enter the acceleration point of that orbit. And looking, even thinking about taking a contrarian position, obviously opposite of what in the direction that CCI is trading, is absolutely simply foolish based on a volatility probability basis. And so, as we look at our chart here of the euro Australian dollar, we can see here that the red lines that I've just drawn, the euro US dollar actually traded down towards negative 100 on the CCI window that you see here. So what does that mean? It certainly doesn't mean that it was nearing an oversold level at all for even 1 second. What it means is that the euro Australian dollar simply started to fall. I can load it here for you. I believe this is Woody CCI. I mean, it's kind of all the same. And Boyke, I just have to look at the calculation underneath that because it's been a while since I looked at it, but I know what you're talking about. But it's really all the same because the bottom line is that when we drop to negative 100 here, it doesn't mean for even 1 second that we were nearing an oversold level. It means we tagged the first standard deviation. That's it. That's it. And then you can see when we actually started to trade above that 100 period, notice this. Does this mean, and I'll draw another red line because I know you can't see my pointer, does this period here, does this mean that we were overbought in the period that I've showed here? As even MetaTrader, even in their explanation, has prompted you to believe, you know, was this overbought? No. All it was the Euro-US or the Euro-Australian dollar trading outside of the first standard deviation on the top side. And let me tell you something else. When you start to trade outside of the first standard deviation in one direction or another, it likely means you're going to trend in that position as well. And so you can see that again, we see the occurrence show up a second time. Think about it. If a distribution is going to move, wouldn't it have to test some of its outliers? Wouldn't it, and especially if it tested the second or the third standard deviation? And sadly, I think what is so important here is almost every single indicator, and you guys, I need to wrap up here in just a moment, almost every single indicator that is presented to the retail community is, one, not clearly explained, is, two, named improperly, and, three, has most traders believe that they should be taking positions completely opposite of the direction that they truly should be. Now, if I were a CCI trader and I were truly, you know, if I understood the principles of it, I would also know, and I'll just move my lines here, that you can see the line that's wiggling back and forth. When CCI dropped below 100, and then it actually came back above, I would know in this instance I could take a position with, obviously, with the CCI coming back in towards the mean, because it also means that the Euro-Australian dollar is basically it's experiencing a period of mean reversion in the direction of the trend. So basically, you're adding a little what I would imagine as an atlatl. Does anybody here know what an atlatl is? It's a stick that I think some of the African tribes would use a long time ago, where they would basically, it's an extension of their arm that they would use to rocket a spear further. And basically, it's a stick attached to their arm, which the spear kind of sits in, and then it just gives them more leverage to throw the spear harder and fiercer. And of course, when CCI is down below negative 100, we know it's traded outside of the first standard deviation. And when it comes back inside or up above negative 100 in the direction of zero, we know that basically it is it's got some momentum as it comes back towards the mean that could help it rocket outside of the opposite side of the mean and the first standard deviation. And when it rockets outside of that first standard deviation, that's really when you're going to start to see moves appear. And so I ask you, please question all of the information that you receive about technical indicators, about what they mean, about the truth behind the data that's being presented, about simple terms like overbought and oversold, which set you up for failure and prompt you to inaccurately take positions that will literally steal your money exactly at the right time when you have the greatest potential risk. And I believe that that for the average retail trader, this is the typical volatility that leaves them scratching their head on a day-to-day basis. But the fundamental problem is that the information that he or she has received in the first place set them up for excessive volatility or a lack of understanding of the volatility. So with this in mind, obviously, if we continue to educate ourselves on what's happening truly underneath markets, we stand not only a significant chance of navigating volatility profitably, but also of making a ton of money and having fun while we're doing it at the same time. Okay, great. Well, again, I'm Mark Whistler with FX Volatility, and I really appreciate everybody's time here. Please have a wonderful day, and please remember that sometimes volatility is not from the market, but perhaps also from within our own misunderstanding of the information that the market is presenting. And thank you guys so much, and please have a wonderful, wonderful afternoon. And Elaine, I'll talk to you later. Thank you guys so much. Thank you.